not a very good praise word, but you seem very enamored of the eccentrics in that film. And in the second film, I think it's not so much about eccentrics as it is about nonconformists who are actually fairly conformist. And it makes me wonder if you see yourself as an eccentric or a nonconformist.
I think I myself is very much a conformist to society. I tend to suppress myself, and I'm not frustrated by that, but I did have, especially when I was making the first film, I did have a lot of venom in myself, and I think I threw that all into the film. I channeled all of my frustrations and complaints about the world into that film, and I was quite young, and that was my film debut as well. So. But after five films, I think I was able to understand for Pale Moon how to seek out the connection between myself and how I relate to society. And I was able to interpret that and make that into a film. So I think it's, for Pale Moon, I was supposed to not just channel all my venom and throw it in, but sort of take a step back and process it within myself.
Any more questions? Hands you.
In the last scene when they were in Bangkok, I suppose. Also, I saw that the letter that the I think other child was having a disaster, and I think the blood was written in pipe also. And in that last scene, would that be the female character is finally
その、まあ、完全に同一人物だって証拠はないですけれども、同じような傷を顔に持った、男性にあって、なんか一つこう刑事のようなものを受け取るって、それは彼女にとってその、なんだろう、まあ、多分横領して、日本の外の海外の国に逃げて、まあ、彼女はもうなんかもう自分が生きてる場所でよくわからないような状態だったと、まあ、僕は思っていて、なんですけど、その見たことでやっぱり自分が昔何をしたかというか、自分が、自分、ある意味、なんとか、自分のこう、 自分自身の性格から自分は逃れられないんだっていう覚悟をね、自分の本質から自分自身が逃げられないんだっていう覚悟が、やっぱり自分の中によみがえってくるというか、だからこそ自分はもうこのまま自分のこのままで受け入れて生き続けなきゃいけないっていう、ある種自分のしたことの責任をちゃんと引き受けた上で、これからちゃんと彼女は具体的に逃げ続けるのか、生き続けるのか、そういう選択を初めて意識的にするという、そこでなんか目覚めるっていう意味では、僕は自由になったとは言いませんけど、自由に一歩近づいたっていう言い方はできると思って、
Continuously embezzling money as an adult, I don't think she remembers what she did as a child and what she did with the donation. But when she meets the man in Thailand and with the same scar on his face as the boy that she donated to, so that's the moment when she has a sort of an epiphany, and she realizes that that's not what. It's not to say that something that she did good, her good intentions as a child came back to her in a good way. It's more as if she became aware that she cannot avoid, she cannot flee from her true nature. That's something that she cannot change. So, and she learned to accept that her true nature cannot be changed. So with this realization, I think she finally took responsibility of her choices and its consequences. And from there, she could either live on or continue to flee. But she was, I think, it's not that she was liberated, but she made a new choice to go on. That's how I shot the scene.
We have time for one or two more questions. Third row, again.
Can you please tell us more about the main casting of Vivi Kayava? And what, I'm sure you had a lot of choices in terms of actresses. Why particularly you chose to work with her, and how did she win this part?
彼女を見るの初めてだね、彼女。彼女は日本ではすごく有名な女優なんですけれども、最近映画にもずっと7年間ぐらい、主演としては出ていなくて、割と結構映画から離れて何をしてるかっていうと、ずっと演劇をやっていたんですね。だから僕もその最近の彼女の演技は知らなくて、もちろんすごく有名な人だから、 昔のもう本当に少女時代からのイメージはすごく強く残ってるんだけど、でそのリカができる女優の候補をいろいろ挙げてたときに、彼女が一番その、彼女が演じるリカがどうなるかが一番こう想像ができなかった。もう少しだからこの、横領して若い恋人に貢ぐ女性銀行員の役を、分かりやすく演じられる女優は他にも、恐らくいたんですけれども、彼女は 本当にどうなのか一番想像ができなかった。だから、割と自分はそういう時にちょっと冒険をするね、習慣があるので、彼女に頼もうと思って。でも実際にその仕事をし始めたら、僕結構演出が細かいんですけれども、その演出の細かさを全く彼女は苦にせず、むしろ喜びとして、服従しつつ、 監督の言うことを100%受け入れながら、それ以上のものを返してくれるっていう、すごくだから、僕としても彼女っていう女優との出会いっていうのは、監督としてすごく大きなことだったというふうに思っています。So
in Japan, the lead actress Surya Miyazawa is quite famous. She's a very famous actress. But in the last 7 years, she stepped away from the screen and she hasn't played any lead roles in quite a while. And in the meantime, she was working in theater. So I couldn't really imagine what kind of performance she gives on screen nowadays. And of course, she's a very famous figure, and I knew her since she was a young woman. But when I was going through the options for actresses to play this lead with Ria and Miyazawa, I could not even begin to imagine what kind of Rika she would portray. But I tend to have a very adventurous side and to take a gamble. I didn't necessarily pick the actress that I could easily imagine playing Rika. But when I saw her perform day to day, and I tend to give very specific, precise direction, but she accepted all of them very joyfully. and she'd accept what the director says 100% and return something so much greater. So it's very fortunate that I got to encounter an actress.
ちゃんとその制作が決定しているものはないので、どれが次になるかわからないですけど、まあ多分一番有力なのはまだ作品名は発表できないですけれども。日本のすごく有名な小説家の、作品原作にした、ものを、まあ、割とまた大幅に脚色して発表する予定です。まあ、早ければ来年12月。
So, I'm working on a few projects simultaneously right now, but, and none of them have been fully confirmed yet, but I think the one with the highest potential is based on a work by a very famous Japanese novelist, and once again, I hope to adapt it as freely as possible and present it, hopefully, at the earliest next year.
Thank you, Yoshida. There is one more film.
まあ、本当に偶然なんですけども、この主演の宮沢りえの、が、舞台でこの同じリンカーンセンターでちょうど1ヶ月後の7月の23日からかな、何日間かの、演劇の公演でニューヨークに来るみたいです。だから同じリンカーンセンターで村上春樹の原作の海辺のカフカという舞台で、すごく美しい素晴らしい舞台ですから、まだチケットが残ってるかどうかちょっと分からないんですけど、ぜひ興味のある人はチェックしてみてください。
So this is a complete coincidence, but the lead, Rei Miyazawa, will be appearing at this Lincoln Center in New York, one month from now, from July 23rd, in the production of Haruki Murakami's Kafka on the Shore. And it's a beautiful, gorgeous production, so please check it out, and I'm sure you'll enjoy it.
And this weekend, you can watch Yoshida's permanent opera this weekend, so please come back for that.
Thank you.